So my name is Kirby, and I'm doing my PhD at the University of St Andrews in Scotland. And well, thanks for inviting me, obviously. And today I'll be telling you a bit about to actually fit the time-dependent model. So this is just adding a number covariance matrix because, yeah, that's how it works. So this is really just us telling the model that each L frequency and each time point will depend on the previous ones, and it will also depend on the consistency across all the replicate population that we have. So the model was very nice already, but we thought, well, we can extend it to make it a bit better, and we've decided to incorporate the effect of genetic drift into it by adding another covariance matrix, obviously. And that is here distinguished by sigma ref. And each element of the sigma ref is just really the expected variance in frequency just caused by genetic drift. And it really, this Fij element here, really depends on genome-wide estimate of the effect of population size. And so we need absolutely to make sure that the estimate that we get is the best possible and least biased. So to do that, we used something that was developed back in 2007 by Jordi and Ryman, and then extended by Jonasil in 2016, where we basically taken into account two sampling steps, associated with this evolving resequencing setup, where they can, for sampling your individuals from the experimental populations and then by fact and accounting as well for coverage, differences in coverage on the genome. And this is just one of those moment-based estimators that estimates the effective population size based on data from two different time points. So I've told you all about my model, and now I'll tell you a bit about a cool application that we've come across. So there's this experiment that was set up in 2002 by Rhonda Snook in her lab back in Sheffield, using fluffless sort of obscura flies that she picked up from somewhere in the US. And then she took these flies to the lab, and she wanted to test some predictions to do with sexual selection. And what she did was just set up two treatments and let it run for approximately 15 years, which corresponds to 200 generations. And so the two treatments are the monogamy treatment, where one female was housed with a single male, and an elevated polyandry treatment, where one female was housed with six males. So what was interesting to us here is really that the fact that we can make predictions about estimates of NPE. So we're trying to compare autosomes with the sex with the X chromosome. We're really expecting estimates of NPE to be much lower on the X. But if we're comparing across treatments, say monogamy versus elevated polyandry, we're expecting selection to be much stronger on the elevated polyandry treatments individuals. So NPE should be definitely reduced in this case. So we wanted to make sure that these predictions we had were corroborated by simulations. So we simulated a chunk of a chromosome based on the fluffalo monogastric haplotype and let it run for 200 generations as well, including selection, stronger or weaker, or just an interest scenario. And as you can see here, the colored lines correspond to the scenarios where there is selection. Estimates of the effective population size were actually much lower compared to what we'd expect in the neutral scenario. So definitely, according to simulations, estimates of the effective population size have been greatly reduced all across these regions. So I've only just started analyzing the data to do with the experiment, but I've sequenced five time points across all the replica populations, and I'm actually just starting to get good data now. But in chromosome 2, it seems as though some of the estimates are actually pretty reduced, which is a bit unexpected, even for scenario where we're having elevated polyandry. But maybe this is because, well, either selection is very strong indeed, or because drift dominates and we can't lose more. So basically, we've seen from simulation work that selection does shape patterns of NPE, and most likely it will be the same when we're estimating the real data, but link selection is probably an issue, so we'll need to account for that in the future if we really want to test for selection and make sure that we have enough power to really detect signatures of selection in genome. So future work, well, there is plenty to do, and our idea really is to incorporate some linkage information so that we can actually account for patterns of varying NPE or combination rate even. The long-term goal here is really to move on from this comparing to models scenario where we're going to be developing a mechanistic model to actually estimate selection parameters, which would be ideal, and potentially actually estimate the effective population size straight from this model. So I'd like to thank Carolyn Oziel. She's a supervisor and she's been super supportive. Thank her to SMU as well as now Stockholm for giving me the data. And well, for listening.